problems and all the trials and all the tests and all the discouraging things that come our way. Anybody ever face discouraging times? But you know what? For every discouraging word, every discouraging situation, I have an encourager. Amen. I got somebody that says, son, you're going to make it. Amen. He said, let not your heart be troubled. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, here's the good news. I'm going to come again, and I'm going to receive you unto myself. But where I am, there ye may be also. Amen. Hallelujah. The Bible says, comfort one another with these words. And when I begin to see all the trouble and all the trials of life, I get a little more excited every day. Because the Bible said in the last days, perilous times will come. Amen. The Bible said when just before Jesus comes, that Satan is going to unleash everything he has. And he's doing that. And I'm telling you, I'm looking forward to heaven. Yes. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. Praise God. You may be seated tonight. The ushers will come. We're going to wait on you for our evening offering. God is good. Hallelujah. And all the time, God is good. Amen. Praise the Lord. One big announcement that I have tonight. If
amen.
You have to miss just one Sunday this year, you do not want to miss this Sunday. I haven't given Cheryl my notes yet because I told her I wasn't fully convinced what I was going to preach today, but I'm kind of leaning in one direction. And if you have to miss one Sunday, you don't want to miss this Sunday. Amen? Praise God. Amen. Bill, would you return thanks tonight as we give us a little more?
But you have not so learned
ungodly, of the heathen. And he's saying, as believers, we don't need to behave the way that the sinners behave. You know what the problem is in the church today? You can't tell the saint from the sinner. Amen or ouch. And a lot of churches don't have a distinctive differentiation. As long as you walk in the door, they'll tell you you're going to heaven. But there's a distinct difference between somebody who's serving Jesus Christ and somebody who does not really truly have a relationship with God. The Bible said in 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. But doesn't stop there, does it? It says what? Old things, what used to be, is gone. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Amen. I'm not going to live the way I used to live. I'm not going to behave the way I used to behave. I'm not going to act the way I used to act. I'm not going to look how I used to look. How many know that when you get saved, you even look different?
Yes.
Amen. People don't understand that, but you watch somebody give their heart to Christ, and when they walk back to their seat, look at the glow on their face that wasn't there before. There's a holy glow, and it wasn't mopping glow. It was the Holy Ghost glow. Amen? Hallelujah. When Moses came down off the mountain, they had to cover his face with a veil because he shone with the glory of God. I remember preaching the 10th crusade years ago, and one night, people getting blessed all over, slain out under the power of God, touched to God, filled up with the Spirit. And one night, a man came into the tent. He said, Brother Joe, he said, last night I never had to turn the headlights on out of the car. I just put my wife on the hood of the car. She glowed with the glory of God so bright. I said, hallelujah. I don't think he really did that, but he was saying, what a difference in the countenance. Amen? And I want to tell you, when we accept Christ, when we are born again, when we come alive with the Spirit of God, there is a change in your attitude. And when your attitude changes, it changes your whole countenance. It changes your whole, the way you carry yourself. Your whole demeanor changes. When somebody's down and discouraged and depressed, you can see it all over them. But when the joy of the Lord is your strength, when you're walking with a clear conscience, when you don't have guilt feelings, when you're not embarrassed or ashamed that you've done something dirty and filthy, but your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you can walk not cocky, but confident. Amen? Not arrogant, but with authority. Hallelujah. And when we come alive, oh, I feel like preaching tonight. I haven't even got into the first verse, and I feel this thing coming off. We need to behave differently when we find Christ than we do before we're saved. I know people tell me they got saved. I said, when? Sure didn't show it. If you've been saved, you're gonna walk different. The Bible said, this I say therefore, verse 17, therefore, and testify in the Lord that you henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk in the what? Vanity of their mind. What does that mean when Paul uses, I'm teaching from the King James, but you might have another translation and that's fine, but what do you think of when you think of the vanity of the mind? What is vanity? Solomon said in Ecclesiastes, vanity, vanity, all is vanity. The word vanity means emptiness. Emptiness. All is emptiness. And he's saying they're walking in the vanity of their mind, the emptiness of their mind. Because everything they think of does not lead them anywhere. Ungodly people don't think like godly people think. We have a renewed mind. Amen? We have the mind of Christ. Amen? And when you have the mind of Christ, you're going to think on those things which are above, not on those things that are of the earth. Amen? When when you start talking to non-believers about spiritual matters, their eyes bug out. They don't know what you're talking about. What do you mean heaven? What do you mean about sanctification? What are you talking about getting right with God? They don't understand. They don't even talk our language. They don't think the way we think. And their mind is an empty thought process. Somebody read Romans chapter 8 and verse 7. And then somebody, it's not going to be up there, but somebody turn to Romans chapter 1. And I want you to read from Romans 1 in just a minute. But Romans 8, 7.
The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so.
The carnal mind is enmity against God. It's against God. The natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit, neither can he know them, because it is foolishness unto him. Amen? But how many know that the foolishness of God is wiser than the wisdom of man? So man, in all of his wisdom, he thinks he's very intelligent. He thinks he's very smart. He thinks he's very wise. But when you get to the end of it, they have an awful lot to share. But I think of the scripture, ever learning and never coming to the knowledge. They're always looking for answers and never finding the right ones. Because all the questions they ask just lead to more questions. Everything that they build on just leads them to find, they have to find something farther beyond that. When God has an answer to every question, because he is the answer to every question. Somebody read for me Romans chapter 1 and verses 21 to 25. Okay. him out in the back and you took care of him because you couldn't afford to feed him if he wasn't going to help bring in some poop bells. Today, you don't even want to, remember talking about kicking the dog or throwing the cat out the window? Don't even talk that way today. It's like mentioning a bomb in an airport. Somebody be all over you like stink out of skunk. We have put the animals above human. They have more rights than you and I have. And if you ever have to take your dog or cat to the vet, they do have animal insurance, health insurance for animals. And I suggest if you have some animals, take health insurance out on them because it's going to cost you more than you can afford to pay to take your animal to the vet. And if you have to put them down, you can't put them down yourself, even if they're ready to go down. You got to take them in and pay your fee so they can do it properly and give them a proper burial. Help me, Jesus. The vanity of their mind, they profess themselves to be wise and they became fools and they shut God out of their thinking. They took him out of the equation. And the Bible said the fool has said in his heart, no God. Who has? The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. One man said, the fool has said in his heart, no God. And yet they talk like they're intelligent and they're educated. My father would always say they're educated beyond the level of their intelligence. They have degrees, but no common sense. Their vanity of their mind, what their thought process leads them to is emptiness. The thought process that man has without Christ takes them nowhere. There is no destination in their thinking. And then it says, and their understanding is darkened. What does it mean if they're walking in the emptiness of their thought life, but their understanding is darkened? What does that mean to you? They don't have a full understanding. If something's dark, you can't see it clearly, all right? In the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4, if we have that. So we want to read it. See, light illuminates, darkness hides. And their understanding has been darkened. They don't have a clear understanding. Remember Saul of Tarsus? How many know who Saul of Tarsus is? Paul the Apostle. Before he became Paul the Apostle. When he was going down to Damascus, after he had just been at Stephen's execution, he was going down to Damascus to lay hold of Christians so he could put them in prison and watch them die and kill them. He was a Hitler. He didn't kill them. He watched them die. He was mass murdering the saints of God. He was, Paul the Apostle was Hitler before he got saved. No, Hitler didn't get saved. Paul got saved. But when he was going down to Damascus, he thought he was doing God a favor. He thought what he was doing was the right thing. Why? Because he didn't have the light of the glorious gospel illuminate the darkness of his understanding. He didn't have a full grasp on what truth was. The Bible says you will know the truth and the truth will make you mad. And free. Probably mad before you're free, but you'll get there. Amen? So here Paul is thinking he's doing God a favor by killing the people of God because why? His understanding was darkened. I want you to know we're living in that day where the Bible says in the last days they will cast some of you into prison and you shall be tried 10 days, but be faithful unto death and you will receive a crown of life. We're living in those days. Don't think we are not. I want tell you right now, your freedom is slowly eroding. Amen, Mark?
Okay. Speaking about that, I said, okay, our worldview has to be the Lord's view. The problem is Americans, we got used to presidents where, well, I don't agree with everything he says, so I'll go along with my life, and what I don't like, I'll go my way. It doesn't work that way with Jesus. He's Lord. When he speaks, it's like in the military. The general may have said, please pick that up, but it was a command to do it. God talks to us nicely, but when he speaks, it's a command. It's not a request if you're his.
He doesn't have a word. He is the word.
Amen.
Amen? He doesn't just speak the word. He is the word. Amen? The word became flesh. And if you're ever going to understand what he's saying, if you're ever going to understand what he's teaching, you need to understand him. That's the problem. We try to learn about him instead of get to know him. We learn about him, but we don't know him.
And as you're saying, we need the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, we can't understand these things.
Because the natural man receives not the things of the Spirit, neither can know them. They're spiritually discerned. Foolishness. So number one, they're vain in their mind. Their understanding is darkened. They have things perverted. They got things back. They're not getting a clear picture. Without Christ, you really don't know right from wrong. You know, we get so upset with sinners for their behavior when they're simply acting the way they ought to act. They're sinners. How do you expect them to act? The problem is when they get saved and they don't change. Christ as we did before we accepted Christ, then there's a problem, and did we really accept Christ? Or did we go through the motions and pray a prayer with our lips, but not allow God into our hearts? The Bible goes on to say they're not only vain in their mind and darkened in their understanding, but they're alienated from the life of God. A message a number of months ago on rebellious life, redeeming love on Hosea. And I talked about the names of their kids. Remember the names of their kids? Jezreel, be sure your sin will find you out. Lo Ruhamah means the spirit will not always strive with man. And Lo Rami, which means you're not a child, and you go from one to, and I talked about the spirit will always strive. What a sad state when you no longer feel guilty for sinful behavior. You don't even know when that day can come. It can come unexpected without even thinking about it. And all of a sudden you're doing things and you have no feeling at all. You're dead. God turned you over to a reprobate mind. What a sad state. God will not always strive with man. God will not always work in man. And they're alienated from life. They don't understand life in Christ because the Bible says in 1 John 5, he that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son hath not life, but the wrath of God abideth in him. They don't have life. They're alienated. What does it mean to be alienated? Separated, set apart, removed from life. They have no life. Those that are apart from Christ are apart from, they're walking dead. I mean, you watch all these TV shows about zombies and walking dead, and I get sick of seeing the commercials on the television. But they don't know how accurate they are. But they don't realize they're talking about themselves. Because in actuality, without Christ, they are the walking dead. They're alienated from life because he that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son hath not life. I, Jesus, am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And he that liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Amen? Where do you find your life? The world thinks they're living it up when they're out getting drunk and high and having their sexual escapades and partying and all hours of the night. They think they're living it up, but really they're making idiots of themselves because their understanding is darkened. until the morning, and they wake up in the light of the day, and their head is stuck in the toilet bowl, and they're wrenching their innards out. They can't get their head out of the toilet bowl, and then they start learning of the idiotic acts they did the night before to embarrass themselves because they are empty in their thinking. Wow. Am I telling it straight? I'm not telling it straight. Paul is. This is what he's telling us. He's saying, you think you're living it up in the world. The truth of the matter is you're alienated from life because your understanding is dark and you are believing a lie, and you're really, your thought process is just, is emptiness. What do you get from going out and partying all hours of the night, running off with somebody else's spouse, doing what you shouldn't do in the wee hours of the morning? What satisfaction do you get when you lose your job because you're a drunk and can't get up to go to work? Where is your head at? I said it again this week, and I've said it for many years, but, I asked myself, and I asked myself literally this simple question. I asked myself often, because how many have ever had times where you wondered if we were really preaching truth? You ever wonder if there really is a heaven? You ever wonder if there is a hell? Even if you've been saved a long time, every now and then the devil comes and will put a little thought in there. What if you're wrong? Look what you're missing out on if you're wrong. And I thought to myself, what am I missing if I'm wrong? Missing a few hangovers. Missing a few missing teeth from the fights I have been in, that I used to get in. I'd be missing some scars, I'd be missing some guilt feelings. If I lived the life I'm living now, I wouldn't have to work. But if I didn't, if I lived the way I used to live, and there is a heaven and there is a hell, you know what I missed? If there is no heaven, if there is no hell, if I'm wrong, I haven't lost a thing, except problems. But if there is a heaven and there is a hell, I've lost everything. And the world thinks they're living. And they think they've got all the answers, but they don't understand that they're understanding is darkened, their mind is empty, and they're alienated from life. Somebody read Psalm 58 and verse 3. It's going to come up on the screen.